Over snow and winter's morn. It's the end of an era for me. If there was one series which shaped my life more than any other, it's the Lord of the Rings trilogy which Peter Jackson gave to us in the early 2000s. I will never forget how I felt in the cinema when I first saw the Ents march on Isengard, or the Rohirrim charging across the Pelennor Fields, or Sam literally carrying Frodo up Mount Doom. These moments have been etched into my mind, along with pretty much the entire movies as a whole by the time I watched them enough times. In effect, Lord of the Rings is my Star Wars. Now, does that make The Hobbit my Star Wars prequels? To say that would mean that I find so little redeeming quality in the Hobbit films that they're just worthless. But honestly, I'm far more mixed on the matter. And those of you who actually watched my reviews of the first two Hobbit movies will have a better idea of that. Just to recap for the rest of you, I liked the first film, but I acknowledged that it had some big flaws. The second one was a big disappointment, with a few good moments that just were outweighed by bad on all fronts. As to this one, the third movie, I would say it falls in between the first and second films. It's a recovery from the second, but it still has quite a few flaws that I cannot overlook. The Battle of the Five Armies is essentially the third act of the book, from the destruction of Laketown to the end of the story. Naturally, this story needs to get stretched out to make for a feature film. But anyway, I'm not going to cover the plot. I'm going to cover the pros and cons of this movie. So what are the things I didn't like? Well, just like the first and second films, I really did not like how over-the-top some of the action got. I remember a time when Legolas surfing downstairs on a shield was the most over-the-top moment of a Lord of the Rings movie. Now you could say that about pretty much all his action scenes. You can also say that about a really stupid death fake-out that is one of the many cliches this film caters to. Hand in hand with this action, some of the designs, while sometimes unique and cool, ended up being randomly strange and distracting. Also, as a book purist, I really didn't like how one character got completely eliminated from the story, and thus robs the story of any real reason to introduce him in the first place. Instead, we get a bad comic relief who I can honestly call the Jar Jar Binks of the series, but the editing room already beat me to that joke. The editing in this film was also choppier than it usually has been. The sexism in the action scenes was also evident in how it could show women deciding to fight, but never actually showing them do so, except for the main character. And speaking of that main character, Tauriel suddenly turns into a damsel in distress near the end of the film that needs to be saved by both her male suitors. But the biggest problem of all, as far as I can tell, is that half the things introduced in the story never get resolved. Seriously, the ending does very little to actually explain what happens to the treasure of the mountain, which is sort of the reason this whole story began in the first place. And that's just one of the things that doesn't get explained, unless you read the book. And just as Harry Potter proved to me, if you haven't been able to answer all the questions in the movie which get answered in the book, it's an example of an unsuccessful movie adaptation when the book readers are asked what the heck is supposed to have happened. But now, what could I have liked about this movie after all that? What was good about the movie? Well, first of all, I liked Thorin Oakenshield and Richard Armitage's performance of Thorin. Hell, I've always liked Thorin, even when the story around him sucked. Thorin was much more developed and interesting in this series than he ever was in the book, and frankly, the movies are just as much his story as they are Bilbo's. And since I've brought him up, I always liked Martin Freeman's take on Bilbo Baggins as well. He's just as good in this film too. The rest of the dwarves are okay in whatever screen time they get. Gandalf was good, Bard the Bowman's character was good, Benedict Cumberbatch as Smaug was still awesome. The White Council's fight with Sauron was great, especially Galadriel's
epic throwback to Fellowship of the Ring. I also liked how Radagast is given a purpose which cements him perfectly into the story's climax. Also, while I think the CGI was very, very excessive in the series, a lot of the designs do look really good. And finally, the farewell song by Billy Boyd at the end of this film is flawless, and hands down the best way they could have ended this series. Having an actor from Lord of the Rings appear to say goodbye, especially one as talented a singer as Billy Boyd, it made me forget for a moment all the problems I had with the Hobbit films. I thought on the legacy of the Lord of the Rings films, the books, the Hobbit equivalents, and just how important they had all been and still are. So no, the Hobbit films are not irredeemable for me. Flawed, certainly, but there was still something to them which brought me back every time.